7/10 of the Earth's surface is ocean. On the high seas, beyond the reach of law, the ships that illegally kill whales, dolphins, and seals can do so with little fear of punishment. But there is one sight that they've learned to dread. The black pirate flag of the Sea Shepherd Conservation Society. Its mission? To stop the killing of all marine mammals. Captain Paul Watson, its founder and leader.
We are vigilantes in the sense that whenever there is no law enforcement body with the jurisdiction to enforce international regulations and laws, we're not going to stand idly by and watch these laws be broken just because no governments have the political will to do anything to stop it. So we've set ourselves up as that law enforcement body. And if the governments of the world don't like that, then they should do something to remedy the situation by coming up with a responsible body to enforce those regulations.
Any tactic which is going to save wildlife, so long as it is not killing another human being, is justifiable.
They are going to ram you. Stand clear.
Draw the line is we don't injure or kill people, but we have no hesitation about damaging property which is being used illegally to destroy the environment, to destroy wildlife. We have absolutely no hesitation there.
Why are you crossing my ship?
Because you're killing too many dolphins, whales, and birds, and taking too many fish.
And you insulted us by calling us creatures.
The Sea Shepherd 2, a 35-year-old former British Arctic trawler, is Watson's flagship. She's escorted by the Edward Abbey, a patrol boat bought from the United States Coast Guard. Miles away across the Pacific Ocean are Sea Shepherd's targets, the growing drift net fleets of Taiwan, Korea, and Japan. The United Nations have an outright ban on high seas drift nets. The drift nets have killed hundreds of thousands of whales, dolphins, and seabirds.
Drift nets are now being used all over the world. And the problem is the reason they're being used is as we have less and less fish, we find that we're having to spend more and more money to catch those less and less fish.
In the North Pacific, the drift net zone is larger than North America. Sea Shepherd will sail across the Pacific to confront her enemies. She will face a fleet of more than 1,000 ships who want one last fishing season in defiance of the United Nations. Watson's aim? To smash expensive fishing gear by ramming the drift netters with the 100 tons of concrete reinforcing the Sea Shepherd's bows.
They're businessmen, they're not fishermen. They want to get as much money as they possibly can in the shortest period of time. And if that means wiping out the fish out of the oceans, I don't think they really care.
Each drift net measures 30 miles. They are indiscriminate, killing everything in their path. In the North Pacific, the target is squid. Thousands of tons are caught. But so are seabirds and dolphins. The drift net is the most destructive fishing method ever devised.
The objective of this campaign is to create an international incident involving drift net fishing, to cut nets, to confiscate nets, to ram vessels if we can, but most importantly, to create an international incident.
Watson ran away to sea at 16, serving in the Norwegian Merchant Marine and in the Canadian Coast Guard. A founder member of Greenpeace, Watson was at the forefront of their early campaigns. But his commitment to whales and dolphins comes from a spiritual experience that he had in the fight for another cause. Wounded Knee, South Dakota. Site of an infamous massacre of American Indians by the US cavalry. And in 1973, a siege. Militant Indians occupied the settlement, demanding the restoration of their ancient lands. Paul Watson joined the struggle as a medic for the Indians and was made a warrior of the Oglala Sioux tribe.
Here were people who were willing to fight for what they believed in. They weren't talking, they were acting. It's all summed up, I think, in the Lakota expression, hokahe, it's a good day to die, meaning that you have to take a stand even if it means that you're going to die.
An initiation ceremony changed his life.
I had a vision in which I saw a buffalo that was struck by an arrow which had a string attached to it. And I was a wolf, and I ran down the hunters of the buffalo. The whale is to the ocean what the buffalo is to the plains, and the arrow was significant of the harpoon. What I took from that vision was that I should do everything in my power to protect the whales and other wildlife, but I shouldn't kill anybody to do it, but I could be as aggressive as I needed.
Paul Watson's struggle is symbolized by the fate of the blue whale, the largest animal that has ever lived. The blue whale grows to more than 100 feet in length and weighs more than 160 tons. Relatively few people have ever seen any of the great whales. The 20th century has driven the blue whale to the point of extinction. ...150,000 blue whales were killed. When the killing stopped, less than 8,000 survived.
During the 1974 first Greenpeace whale campaign, we encountered the Russian whaling fleet off the coast of California. And our idea to save the whales was to put ourselves between the whales bodily and the whalers. And at that time, while we were pursuing a pod of 8 sperm whales, the whaler fired over our head and he struck a female in a pod of sperm whales. And suddenly the bull came full out of the water and dove, and we had been told that the whale would attack us. And we were waiting with a lot of anxiety for this whale to do just that, when I turned because the ocean erupted behind me and the sperm whale had thrown himself out of the water straight at the harpooner on the bow of the Russian vessel. And they fired a harpoon that was not attached, and it exploded and the whale fell back and died. And as it was screaming and rolling in the water, blood everywhere, I looked up past these 6-inch teeth into an eye the size of my fist. And what I saw there was understanding, that the whale understood what we were trying to do. Because he could have very easily come forward and crushed us or seized us in his jaws and killed us. And instead, what he did was slowly slide back into the water, eye to eye contact all the way, and went beneath the waves and died. What I also saw in that eye was pity. Pity not for himself or his kind, but pity for us that we would be capable of committing such an abominable act against nature.
The Dall's porpoise is the fastest animal in the sea. Once common, it's now increasingly rare. The drift nets are slaughtering them.
First time we went out, we left from Seattle, we were going on a drift net campaign, and all of a sudden all these porpoises, Dall's porpoises, came on the bow, and everybody ran up to the bow, and everyone was really excited. We had a lot of people who weren't veteran crew members. None of us had seen a dolphin in the wild or a porpoise. I didn't even know Dall's porpoises existed. And it was just a really amazing feeling because it seemed like they were leading us to the drift net fleet.
I would have never thought that I would be working in an engine room of a ship, but I love it. It's the heart of the vessel, and you really feel connected with the ship in every way. I don't really feel that it's that dangerous. I suppose I feel that it's something. Danger is something that you create amongst yourself. Like, if we're doing this, we try to do it as safe as possible. You know, we take the precautions that we can and everything like that, but that doesn't mean that we're going to stop doing it. I mean, I'd much rather die in an accident at sea than live a life in port, which I don't agree with.
There are 28 volunteers on this mission. The crew work long shifts, keeping the Sea Shepherd's aging engines running. It's a life of poverty. No one, not even Paul Watson, is paid. Sea Shepherd survives on donations and its 20,000 strong membership. All the money goes into keeping the ships afloat.
When I first crossed the Pacific in 1968, I noticed at the time just how incredibly abundant sea life was. Dolphins, whales, marine birds, and I've watched the steady decline in the number of sightings over the years, so that now it's practically a desert out there compared to what it was in 1968. Especially with seabirds, you just don't see seabirds anymore. And they used to really accompany the ship in scores continuously throughout the trip, and now you can go days and days without seeing any at all. What we're looking at here is a biological holocaust of unprecedented proportions.
In 1978, Paul Watson founded Sea Shepherd, quitting Greenpeace for more direct tactics. He stopped the Japanese dolphin kill on Iki Island by threatening to sink the islanders' boats. In 1981, Watson invaded Siberia to collect evidence of illegal Soviet whaling. Evading warships and helicopter gunships, he escaped. And in 1986, Sea Shepherd agents sank 2 Icelandic whalers. half the country's fleet.
We're here to say things people don't like, to do things people don't want to be seen done. So we don't really measure our support by how happy we make people feel with our actions. The more we can annoy people, the more we can make issues controversial, I think that's where we measure our effectiveness.
To save fuel, Edward Abbey is towed to the Driftnet zone. The ships keep a low profile, but any passing cargo vessel is hailed. It may have sighted Driftnetters.
De dónde vienen ahorita?
Sí, venimos de Long Beach. Long Beach, vamos a Yokohama. Disculpe, ¿hacia dónde se dirigen y qué son ustedes?
He's asking what we are and what we're doing.
We're on a delivery to Vancouver.
Vamos a deliviar unas cosas a Vancouver.
Ah, muy bien.
¿Han visto any barcos por allá?
Negativo, negativo, no hemos visto nada.
We haven't seen anything.
Okay, pues, entonces, que tengan buen viaje.
Muchas gracias, ustedes también, bien viaje.
Sí. Well done.
Who the hell were you last year? Awesome.
they just came from up north somewhere. He didn't say exactly where they're headed for Long Beach.
No, we didn't say exactly where either, did we?
The next ships they see will be the Driftnet fleet.
Copy, over.
Abby, this is Sea Shepherd.
Nice catch.
The expedition is 800 miles from land.
No, that might be okay.
The radio operator checks in with base.
Yeah, we're calling to see if anyone called in with any information. Any information, over?
Yeah, a group of Driftnetters have been sighted at 45 North, 160 West. Over.
Can you tell me where that came from?
Yeah, from the American Albacore fleet. Over.
Okay, it's from the Albacore fleet. Can you tell me if what kind of ships they were?
The report says Taiwanese. Over.
Were they Taiwanese longliners or Driftnetters? Over.
Oh, they were definitely Driftnetters.
The Driftnetters are more than a week away. When he finds them, Paul Watson's methods will be simple and direct. He will ram them.
If you just look at the law of physics, that if you take 700 tons of steel and ram it into 700 tons of steel, there's a lot of metal there to absorb the energy of the blow. So a ramming doesn't really knock anybody off their feet. And so you can do it without injuring anybody. We do have to be very aware while we're doing this for the unpredictable human reactions. And so you have to be ready to make a last-minute adjustment to avoid any injury.
The unpredictable has happened. 1991, off the mouth of the Amazon. Watson fights a long battle with a Taiwanese ship. Blows are exchanged by both sides.
Yeah, in the past, we sustained quite a bit of damage when we've been rammed on the side, so we put out this device here, which we call the mother of can openers, and it keeps vessels from coming up alongside. If they do, then we pierce their hull and cause them more damage than they would cause us. This is a water pump that we got from the Royal Navy, a surplus, and what we do is use it to power a water cannon, which will repel anybody trying to come on board or to keep vessels away from us. We can focus it on the smokestacks and threaten to cause damage to their engine. So it's one of our nonviolent defense systems. Well, in the past, we've been able to secure barrels of pie filling from the U.S. Department of Agriculture. They're surplus barrels. And we can get an attachment from a water cannon and drop that into the barrel. So it can suck up all 45 gallons within a few seconds and send it out the barrel of the water cannon using the water pressure as the vacuum pump. And with this, we can fire a 45-gallon shot of lemon meringue or Boston cream pie at anybody trying to board us. It usually serves to be an effective deterrent.
Watson also carries firepower. His pride and joy is a quarter-pound American Civil War cannon mounted on the stern of the Edward Abbey.
You know, originally people started calling us pirates and said, you're no better than pirates. And we figured, well, we might as well. If they're going to call us that, we'll be pirates. But then we also remembered that the Royal Navy couldn't shut down piracy in the Caribbean. That fell to Henry Morgan, a pirate.
Setting a pirate to catch a pirate is just what Watson did. In 1979, his target was the Sierra, the world's most infamous pirate whaler. The Sierra defied all laws, concealing its ownership and killing any whale that it came across.
The Sierra was the most notorious of the pirate whalers. It had been operating for years and killed 25,000 whales illegally. And I think it was very important for us to put it out of commission, considering that no laws in the world were being enforced against it, and it was a complete out-and-out pirate.
At the helm of his first ship, the Sea Shepherd 1, Watson found the Sierra operating off the Portuguese coast. It was too dangerous to sink her on the high seas, so Watson chased the pirate to its rendezvous with a Japanese freighter. Close to port, he twice rammed the Sierra, once across the bows, where the harpoon was mounted, and then again amidships, ripping the pirate open beneath the waterline. The Sierra managed to struggle into harbour. Months later, saboteurs placed a limpet mine on the Sierra's hull, finishing the job that Watson had started.
The first mate on the Sierra, after we rammed the Sierra, he said to an American television network that it was the only way they could have been stopped. And when he was later questioned about how he felt about it, he said, when I saw how people were willing to risk their life to protect the whales, I began to think about what I was doing. And I'll never kill a whale again. And if Sea Shepherd wanted me to crew on their vessel, I'd be happy to join them. Now, I think that if you can get one harpooner to put down his harpoon and become a whale saver instead of a whale killer, that is a very important educational achievement, much more so than convincing a million people in Britain to not kill whales. They're not going to kill whales anyway. So if you can get the whalers to lay down the harpoon, that is an achievement.
The whales are exceptionally intelligent, exceptionally majestic creatures, and it's the criminal operation to indulge in killing them. I don't care what the laws of any nation or international laws say, the killing of whales is completely and totally unacceptable.
The Norwegian Lofoten Islands, high in the Arctic Circle. 1992. Norway announces the resumption of coastal whaling of the minke, a small whale found in large numbers around the islands. A decision taken within its rights under International Whaling Commission rules.
The reason why we hunt whales are the same as why we do the fishing. It's our living. And If you have a look here, if you have a look in the village where I live, 400 people, it's hardly space enough for our houses between the mountains and the sea. There is nothing else to live from. And we want to stay here. We have done so for 1,000 years, living from fish, whales and seals, and we have done it sustainably.
Watson acted before whaling could start. Under cover of the Arctic night, Watson and two others board the Nibrena, a Lofoten Island whaler. They sabotage its engine, open the seacocks, and escape. The Nibrena was saved by the chance arrival of its owner. He stopped the inrushing seawater just before it sank. Paul Watson's action has hardened the whaler's resolve to carry on.
I was very disappointed when I realized that it was sabotage. And when I was told afterwards who was behind it, I realized straight away that the man, well, he must be sick. I could not say that I was angry, but of course I am very disappointed over what has happened. He has to have psychiatric help, because the man is quite obviously mad.
Paul Watson, he's eating beef, he's eating pigs. For some reason, he don't eat whales and seals. And you know, if somebody came to Britain or to US from India telling you to not kill cows, maybe even blowing up your slaughterhouses, I think you would think that this was crazy, that somebody wanted to impose their symbols, their culture values on you. But this is what Paul Watson is trying to do.
We cannot let terrorists govern the world. It won't do. My brother, Jan Odin, and I have sent a letter to the American president. We've made him aware that he has terrorists operating from American soil, who've come up here to the peaceful Lofoten Islands and sunk boats and frightened children and families. So we appeal to the American president to punish them according to American law.
This is all just a lot of rhetoric, you know, because one person's violence is not another person's violence. One person's terrorist is another person's freedom fighter. We're involved in a war here, a war to save the planet. Now, nobody thinks twice about questioning soldiers whether they're defending oil wells or real estate. I mean, we're involved in a war to save life here. And I'm surprised that it hasn't escalated into combat, and it probably will one of these days as things become more desperate. The fact is that we have never injured anybody. We have no intention of injuring anybody, and I think that we can control the situation to ensure that we don't injure anybody. After that, they can say whatever they like. Frankly, we don't give a damn.
Check the chart, we're half mile now, half mile from fishing grounds.
So where does that put us with ships? When do we expect to see them?
We see them anytime. We see them any minute, actually.
You wanna check the radar?
Yes. Not there yet, but soon, soon.
The Sea Shepherd has finally entered the drift net zone. The challenge now is to find the drift netters. With battle approaching, one of the engineers, Ian Banfield, puts a war totem on the ship's bows.
Right, it's a carved wooden dolphin which was given to me by some very close friends in Australia, one of whom was a first mate on the Sea Shepherd about 10 years ago. And just this morning I was just thinking about it and I realised I still had it, been carrying around for about 2 years. And it just seemed very appropriate to mount up in the bow because it's a bit like the dolphin striking back at the Japanese drift netters, because, I mean, they're killing tens of thousands of these beautiful marine mammals every year in the drift nets.
suddenly two radar contacts are made. Out here, they can only be drift netters. The two ships move to battle stations. A Zodiac inflatable boat takes Paul Watson to the faster ship. Sea Shepherd prepares for ramming. The Edward Abbey and Paul Watson move ahead to select a target.
What's your situation?
We're just getting the Zodiac loaded, and they're working on the bow still, so that might be a few minutes before we can get underway. Zodiac up, we'll be at slow ahead and turn around and make for the other vessel.
Where the other vessel is, do you have a position on
them? Yeah. Well, they're northeast of our position, 6.5 miles.
Northeast, 6.5 miles?
6.5 miles northeast of our position right now.
The Edward Abbey sights a Japanese drift netter on the horizon. Watson closes on his quarry at high speed. One end of a drift net is spotted.
The net's in the water. I'm going to have to edge around it. So, position 4128, 16202. Do you have that, over?
Yeah.
Woo! Look for that, you can get that net.
The Sea Shepherd will pull up the drift net before it can kill dolphins.
Pulling us around and stuff.
We still got some headway.
Yeah, come to starboard a little bit. Looks like you're gonna blow out.
Coming over starboard, but we're dead in the water. You know how it is when we're slow. We'll get it one way or the other. We put a Zodiac in if we have to.
Let's get that line to me right here. I hope you're living.
Need more?
Yeah.
Here we go. Here, just put it over top.
Is there a float on there too?
Yeah.
Okay, we can maneuver the ship around. I don't want the beacon to go back. Get ready to cut the beacon if we have to.
I'm just trying to knot on this thing.
The Japanese drift netter continues to lay its 25-mile net, now shadowed by the Edward Abbey. The ship is the Janai Maru 68. From Hachinohe in Japan. The Sea Shepherd has hit trouble. The drift net has become entangled in the propeller. The bosun will dive to cut the prop free.
have to just go in first and take a look at it and then come right back up and tell us what's going on. Just go in and check it out first, Mark. Even if you don't put your tank on, just go down with your mask and see what you got down there, then come right back up.
It's dangerous work. Light is fading fast. Driftnet can kill a diver as easily as it can kill a dolphin. With the Sea Shepherd stranded, the Japanese ship moves out of range.
I freed the net. I cut the net from the prop. But there was so much net around the prop, my knife got dull and it's very turbulent. So I kind of just gave up on that and cut the net loose. At least we can bring that in now, but the prop is wound up. We'll need more air. I'm out of air.
That's good. Just hold it. All right, Jimmy, that's cool.
Ooh, this is nasty stuff. Snag me and I'm standing on deck.
Snag please.
Watson abandons the first drift netter to hunt for a target closer to the Sea Shepherd. But Sea Shepherd fouls the net again. This time the divers must work in darkness, and four drift netters are bearing down on the stricken ship.
They're about 2 miles away. We've got the drift netter behind them that evidently may be setting net, because I don't recall any net to that side of us. Uh-huh. All the net that we were dealing with was over here, so evidently there's two drift netters with net.
Okay.
So this is the second drift netter. The other one is 6 miles off to our southwest. And it may be trying to pull in the net.
Okay, well, as soon as he comes up, I'll give you an update on where we're at.
The Edward Abbey comes racing back to help.
Yeah, the Zodiac in the water, over.
Yes, it's around the stern of the boat right now. We have a diver in, but we do have a Zodiac in the water.
I got a net right in front of me.
Bummer.
Okay, Shepherd, this is Abby. We just got over it, all right. Yeah, we figured that we gotta hit it really hard, then shut the engines and coast right over top. Over.
Yeah, well, I wish we had that feature. Over.
Finally, the propeller is cleared, and the divers come up. With the Zodiac inflatable recovered, the Sea Shepherd gets underway. A new target is selected. The Jinai Maru 78, a sister ship to the first drift netter. Paul Watson returns to the Sea Shepherd. His intention? To ram. Sea Shepherd's secret weapon is prepared. The world's most powerful stink bombs.
Butyric acid. We're going to use it to throw it at the Japanese drift netters. We're going to aim at crucial parts of the boat, the power blocks, their wheelhouse. We're going to try and get in some of their net storage. And use it to basically take the boat out, make it so it's a puke gas boat. It's just a nauseating gas that's very, very strong odor, very pungent. It makes people throw up and it makes your eyes burn, and it doesn't go away. You can't wash it off. It's powerful stuff.
To minimize the danger to both ships' crews, Paul Watson waits until dawn.
Randy tries swimming at a couple of feet.
Okay, we got it.
Oh,
yeah.
78, Mayru 78, we are going to ram you. Stand clear.
Sea Shepherd is about to hit, but the Japanese deck crew won't move. At the last second, Paul Watson throws the helm to port.
That guy wouldn't back off. I had to swerve away at the last moment. I couldn't hit him. Yeah, I smell it. They're stinking.
You can't be too comfortable in their wheelhouse.
I hate the door of the wheelhouse.
Did the other one didn't break?
There's one small one about that big on the bow. I don't think you even saw it.
How many were there?
I saw three break on the wall and one break on the wheelhouse on the superstructure, and I saw one break on the deck. There was one in the net doors in the back.
Tell Peter to fire a couple of shots across their bow.
Mayru 78, this is the Sea Shepherd 2. Stop your engines, stop your engines. No one will be hurt. Stop your engines.
Okay, the boat really stinks.
Yeah, I know, we can smell it from here.
We can definitely smell it from here. They're slowing down.
Oh, good. Well, we'll try and keep up. Gaining at all?
No.
But he can go faster than that. I don't understand why he's keeping that speed.
Well, it's so hard to really work.
Oh, we snapped their net, so we got to go back and get that net. But
Sea Shepherd is ready to ram again, and now Watson wants the Edward Abbey to fire directly at the drift netter.
A couple in the stern right at the water line. Nobody's there. Over.
Peter says there's no one there that won't even know him.
They must hear it when they hit.
To the relief of many crew members, the order is not carried out.
Yeah, over.
Yeah, confirm. You got to swab that thing out between rounds.
Yeah, it's already loaded. Over.
The Edward Abbey fires a cannon shot across its bows. Still, the Japanese ship does not stop.
Can you change over?
Not yet. The problem is we only have about 100 more degrees on the pyrometer, so...
What's that mean?
It means that we can't go any higher on the exhaust.
You saw water cooling. You should cool it down, huh?
Not the exhaust, no.
Trying to catch this guy. Not too worried about him catching us. Hey, Abby, what's happening? Over.
Then disaster strikes.
Broken valves, we have no
water cooling system. We're down to 9 knots now.
So no what?
No water cooling system, so that's where we're dead slow.
So we give up, hey, do we? Is that it?
No, they're working on it.
Well, we've lost some, yes.
A crucial valve on the engine has blown. The Sea Shepherd comes to a stop.
Yeah, Abby, they broke down here, so I don't know. If you can't stop them, I guess we're not going to be able to catch up.
It takes half an hour to replace the valve. The drift netter escapes, and Sea Shepherd turns to recover the net cut during the ramming. All day, the crew pull in the net. Each section recovered means less dolphins will die. albatross gather for the easy pickings. They too become entangled.
I tried to pick one up off the deck. It was alive.
Yeah. That was alive. Somebody get that in the water.
Go, go, go. That way.
Paul Watson orders his ships home. The Sea Shepherd's engines are too unreliable to continue. But Watson has got his wish, an international incident.
Sea Shepherd. This is U.S. Coast Guard aircraft 1702. The Japanese government has informed the U.S. State Department that you acted grossly negligent and endangered human life.
Negative. There was no damage sustained on any of the vessels involved, and there was no endangerment of anybody's life. Over.
We had reports of some dangerous activity.
We pursued and chased two vessels that we found, and cut the nets on one of them, confiscated the nets on both of them. You can pass on to the U.S. Coast Guard and to the government of Japan that we take full responsibility for our actions, and if they wish to pursue this in court, then we will cooperate fully, and we'll also cooperate fully with the United States Coast Guard in any investigations.
Okay. What's your next port of call, sir?
Our next port of call is Vancouver. Over.
Roger. Coast Guard aircraft 1702 out. Channel 16.
No action is taken against Sea Shepherd. The only laws broken are minor infringements of navigation regulations. For Paul Watson, it's time to retire his aging flagship.
It's been very frustrating using the Sea Shepherd because drift netting vessels, tuna boats, most of the ships that are more modern are faster than she is. And so it's very frustrating to be left in their wake and not being able to do anything to stop them.
Sea Shepherd 2 approaches her final anchorage, Vancouver Island, Canada.
I'd like to get something faster and also ice strengthened. That's both a strong hull and but with faster speed, if we can find something. We've been looking also at the possibility of getting a submarine, a former military submarine. Probably more effective than a ship. At the same time, you can approach ports and divers can leave without being noticed, and for the purpose of sabotaging whaling vessels or whatever.
Sea Shepherd 2 comes to rest. She served Paul Watson well, a warrior of the ocean wars, a rebel to the end.
Be a royal pain in the rear end to people today, but I think we make great ancestors, because from a vantage point of hundreds of years in the future, this will be the generation which destroyed the planet for the future. And the only people who are going to be respected are those people who have actually done something to salvage this planet for the future.